in the discussion, and just guide us and lead us, and all that may go for your glory. Thank you for all the professors and all the students who are learning, and we pray that we might learn accordingly with your will, and all that we are doing today might go for your glory. So we give thanks in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, brother. That's great. Okay, well, we've come to the final class and an exciting semester. I hope you've enjoyed this as well. Really appreciate so much all the lectures that the various professors have given. And we just really appreciate so much their investment in what we're doing here. Everyone from Dr. Talbert to Dr. Collins, Dr. Shoemate, and who am I missing, Dr. Arnold? I feel like I'm missing one person.
Dr. Casillas.
Yeah, Dr. Casillas, that's right. Of course, who gave us the brilliant lecture on the Abrahamic covenant.
One more helpful.
And Dr. Shoemate, I mentioned, yes. I would just ask, I was just thinking about this. If you would like to write into our Gmail account, acacstudies@gmail, and if you're interested, you could just give a little word of comment. Thanks to those men. We could pass that on to them. And I think they would really enjoy just hearing how their lectures particularly benefited you. And obviously they've jumped on here as a labor of love and just are really so excited that they could be extend their ministry to you. So very good. I was going to pull up our syllabus, what we've been doing for the semester. And we want to look at that. We want to talk about the paper today. And we also want to discuss some questions that you've had. And we can even take some open Q&A if you haven't been able to actually do that as well. Joel, do you have that syllabus? I have it here.
Sure.
Yeah.
Put it up.
Yeah, it'd be great.
Okay, I'm sending out the link if someone wants to open up the link, and then we can screen share it as well. So, Dr. Urbanman, I'm just putting it up here.
Okay. Do you see that? Great. So here's this is what we've been doing. We began way back in January, middle of January, with our initial week one with introduction to the course, what is biblical theology? And of course, we went to creation, fall, redemption. And then we've been working through diachronically the scriptures after those introductory lectures, and we've gone through all the way through the Pentateuch, the prophets, the Psalms, exilic, post-exilic books. We've come into the New Testament and the Gospels, the Acts and Epistles, Revelation. And then we started looking through different topics. We changed the order a little bit here, but we did a couple topics in missiology. We talked a little bit about the Abrahamic and, the New Covenant from Dr. Talbert. We had two lectures by him on that, or two different days. We talked about the center, which is a major issue in introductory issue for biblical theology. We talked about continuity and discontinuity, and here we are today. So we've been looking at some of your questions and that you're asking. And we also want for you to put some questions in the chat here that you'd like us to discuss today. And we have some things we want to talk about. But I think maybe Dr. Arnold, I'm thinking that maybe it'd be a good idea for us to go ahead and touch on the paper, because that's something we definitely want to fit in. And we don't want to extend ourselves and then have to be cut it short for people's questions on that and what they're doing in that regard.
Sounds great. I do have, and I'll go ahead and paste it in here just so you can go ahead and download it if you want. I compiled all the questions, and so they're all in one document. I added some kind of stray thoughts here and there, and they're just bullet points. I read through and thought through each one of the questions, and I kind of have a prepared answer for each, but I left it pretty blank. So if you want to make your own notes and such, like, I've got some bullet points and just some thoughts initial there, and we can work through that later on. So there you can see everybody's questions kind of in one document.
Great. Very helpful. Yeah, I've done the same. I've gone through and read the questions and did some thinking through them as well. And so I think that'll be great to be able to get into that. But I'd like to really jump into that paper, because I feel like that's, I want to make sure people have topics. People don't feel like this is the last class and we're kind of putting them out there and they still don't know quite what to do their paper on, or they feel like they, are not ready for that. So could you maybe just even in the chat, tell us what paper what your title is or what your topic is, or you say, maybe I don't have one. You could say that as well. And then we'll talk a little bit about the format as well. I know we've talked about, for some of you, we've talked about different topics. Maybe you can just put in there, this is what I'm planning on doing. There's a couple comments. Okay. The Son of Man in Daniel 7. All right. So with that paper, will you go, you're going to go beyond the actual chapter of Daniel 7, right? Great. That'd be great. And you can trace really the whole idea that the topic Son of Man in really Genesis, starting with Genesis, going through Revelation, and then looking at key passages. Yeah, good. Into the New Testament as well. Great. And you can differentiate, you know, Ezekiel is called the Son of Man. You know, what's the difference there? And of course, that's Jesus' favorite self-designation. Great. Okay. Wonderful. We look forward to seeing that. Yes. Yeah. So let's just talk a little bit about that. How will you, with the Son of Man paper, Joel? How would you, just giving some, throwing out some ideas of how to go about doing that? Maybe we can talk a little bit about that. What are some things we would expect in that paper, Dr. Arnold?
Yeah, I mean, I would probably. I'm just trying to think if I was going to sit down and write a Son of Man paper. You would definitely want to trace. Even the background of the son of type of expression, which is honestly a linguistic thing. It's really an exegesis thing, but it's part of your foundation. And then give a general overview of son of man expression in the Old Testament leading up to Daniel 7. You've just got to, you know, you can't put too much time into that or you're not going to have time for the important stuff. But anyway, you want to give that background, maybe a paragraph, a couple of paragraphs to explain that. You get into Daniel 7, you're definitely going to want to follow the flow of thought and then point out some of these really amazing things going on there. Somehow this person is human, but this also person also receives authority from the Ancient of Days. And then you're going to come into the New Testament and you're just going to walk through the Gospels the way Jesus used that expression. If I was going to do that work, I would be searching for the expression Son of Man, and I would plan to read every single place in the Bible that Son of Man is used. And then I'm going to highlight, maybe I'm going to pick out the ones that really stick out. And I'm going to start putting them into groups. So I'll probably create a little outline in my notes that are, you know, is just where I'm putting different categories of the way Son of Man expression is used all the way through the Gospels. You're going to find that it happens in Acts and not really in the epistles. So probably what you're going to do is the Gospels and Acts as a group, and then you're going to leave climactically after Revelation, where you have two instances in Revelation, and that's going to be your whole idea. Last thing, your conclusion, you would just kind of put all the pieces together, show us how they fit. And that's essentially a biblical theology of Son of Man.
Great. Excellent. And that's on a recording. So you can go back and listen to that again and think through that. So that's helpful. Great. Okay. Who else is doing a topic? let's talk through. Let's do at least maybe one more, and just make sure we know where people are at. You're writing a paper.
Brother Kenneth, could you? I know we had talked a little bit. Are you settled in on something yet, or what are you thinking?
Okay, I think you're adding maybe to the discussion we just had.
I know I also heard from Brother John Glass that you were talking about your topic as well. Anyway, anyone really jump in if you've got a topic, or even if you're just kind of starting to think about things, happy to hear. While maybe we're waiting for another answer, I will post or paste in here one of the students wrote, or a set of questions, topics that a student wrote us about, and I thought they were excellent. I think actually any of these could be great. The middle one, number three, is probably the most demanding in a way, because you would have to do it just right for it to be an academic paper. So it would take a lot of skill. I would think in terms of, unless you're a really skillful writer, maybe not number three. But the other ones that are there are topics that you could trace really effectively. There's a lot that you could do there. So, yeah.
Okay.
Two people were asking here about format. And, you know, here's, as far as format goes, I don't know if you've heard of Turabian, but Turabian is the bane, it's the frustration of seminary students. And yet it's kind of the way it's done. And particularly if you have in your vision or in your future that you want to do a thesis, you want to do a dissertation, you have to do Turabian. You just do. I hated Turabian. Dr. Oberlin hated Turabian. Everybody hated Turabian, but you just have to do Turabian.
And it's, I kind of like it actually.
It's a format. It's a method that kind of lays things out for you. So, maybe what we'll do, maybe you have it handier than I do, Dr. Irving, or I can look, but we can send you a template. And that template is just, you basically will just follow the example of what it does. So if you follow that template, you're going to get it. You're going to get what you're
gonna do. Yeah, I have an updated template. Let me work on that, sending that here from Turabian 8. I don't know actually if Turabian 8 is the latest, but it's pretty late. It's not the latest. I'll send that out here shortly.
Awesome. Perfect. So that'll give you an idea of format. And you'll just see there, it's double space. You'll see that when that comes across, you can get an idea there. If you're interested in this, maybe I'll pull up an example paper. I was looking at something today in answer to one of the questions we had here. Give me a brief second. And I will show you just kind of an example of what a Turabian paper looks like. Here we go. So when you're doing a Turabian paper, there's a certain format you're expecting on the front page, for a certain format as you go through, and then there's a certain format also for your headings, and each one of those things you're expected to keep up with. I'm pulling up my dissertation here, and that'll give you an idea if you're interested. All right, so your front page, you're who you are, and something about the, you know, that's some information about the paper itself. This part is not necessary, that's dissertation specific. As far as the paper itself is going to go, you're going to be doing double spaced, and you're gonna have footnotes underneath, and then you're gonna have headings and so forth. The biggest thing about these headings is that you're consistent. And then there's a certain format here at the bottom. Pay attention to the way somebody lays out there when they cite a book, and you'll get some ideas there. We also have some things we can send you if you're not sure how that works. So that's also part of the way you do Turabian. Here's just one comment about academic writing. If possible, it's good to have a lot of this kind of content footnote in the bottom. And basically what you find yourself doing a lot of is you will write up above the flow of your argument, and below you will have kind of the evidence or the data or the proof or the argumentation. So the more academic your writing is, the more you probably tend to rely on a lot of content below. It doesn't have to be excessive, but it's part of what you're doing as you go along. Scripture references for a biblical theology, I'm primarily putting the references up in the text. So I don't think you just want to put all your biblical references down below. I do some things like you've seen in the things I've sent you guys. I will have a point that has like 20 references. I don't want to clutter up my text with that. So I'll put a footnote and I'll put my list of 20 references below. So if you have like 20, 25 references, sure. But if you just quote something, put it in a parentheses. I don't think you want to put a footnote for every single scripture reference. It's going to get ridiculous.
Okay, I sent you that this link to the Turabian 8, and basically it's a paper that shows you different headings, and you can just copy right over that. You can type right over the words that are there. And so everything's set up, the table of contents, I can go through that in a little bit more of a tutorial, but maybe I won't take the time right now to do that, because I could actually get off into like a 5-10 minute tutorial, and I think maybe that's not what we should do at this moment. But I'm curious if there's any other things you're wondering about. You're saying, hey, I don't have a good topic, and I really would love I would love for Dr. Arnold to flesh out my topic too on video. Anybody else have something like that they would like? You're looking at something. You're working through something. And I just don't want to leave anybody out.
If you have things that, you know, you're working with a topic and you're not sure what resources to go for, message me and message Dr. Oberlin, and we'll try to find you some resources or give you some pointers to something that can help you. So this is all part of the process. I think even if you get stuck in the process, message us. I mean, really where the learning happens is in the doing, like this thing, the Son of Man. It's yeah. Going to be the work of you're going through all the references. That's where you're learning. So no secrets here. You know, if you're wondering about something, just ask us. We'll tell you. If you want to send a paper ahead, we can look at it and kind of give you an idea how you're doing and tell you if you're going in the right direction, things like that. So.
And there are a lot of online resources. There's probably more than many of us are aware of. I keep finding new resources every day, new articles, even books, entire books that are just kind of stuck out there on the web. You can just go right to a link and there it is in PDF format and you can read it. So there's a lot of helpful stuff I think we'll be able to use beyond just even actual libraries. Great. Should we move on?
Great. Question popped up here, when is next semester? And this is, we're still working. I'm communicating with several of the guys who would be adjunct teachers, try to work out those details. But I'm thinking probably like early May, something like that. Any comment there, Dr. Oberlin? Any thoughts you have?
That sounds great. Yep, absolutely. Do you want to go ahead and announce what we're doing?
Yeah, well, we talked about hermeneutics briefly last time. Maybe I'll give you a little bit more of information and kind of, I guess, maybe a bit of a teaser. But this is the process of doing your Bible study. Lord willing, starting early May or around that time is what we're talking about. Again, it's just like what we did here. It's going to be on an advanced level. So expect it to be challenging, but expect it to be good. In the first lecture, talking about definition of hermeneutics or interpretation, how this relates to the other disciplines, we've done that here. Systematic foundations for hermeneutics and just some of the basic givens or the assumptions we have to make. And a brief discussion of textual criticism. We can't get into this because it's going to be a more detailed class that would be touching on that. Second lecture would be history of hermeneutical philosophy. Reader response is kind of a philosophical idea that's in vogue in or that's popular with hermeneutics. The hermeneutical spiral is the answer to that. And contextualization is really interpreting in your context, your specific place, your specific needs, and the things that you're dealing with in your context. Original language is one, why do them, and a philosophy of words. This maybe sounds boring, I don't know. This is really, really important, really important. We use words all the time, we don't understand them. We as humans, we don't understand language. And Mark Ward, Lord willing, will be doing this. I took advanced New Testament word study with him, really good teacher, and he's very interested in this kind of thing. This will be a good lecture. This will be a lot of fun. Original languages too. How do you relate grammar, and how does grammar affect your interpretation? Lexical and grammatical, is it always significant? And the comment I made here as we were thinking through this together, basically it's the idea that not every detail in the text is a significant detail. A good exegete has to learn which things matter and which things are important. Specific examples working through Old Testament and New Testament. This is pretty, this will be an interesting discussion, and I'll show you a brief example of something I've been working on here recently that is a form of this. This is an attempt to understand how to analyze an individual text, and it's the recognition that there are lots of ways to kind of, quote, diagram a text. So I was just working on something for a class that I taught today, working in Ephesians 1, and if you do that, break down every word in Ephesians chapter 1, you kind of get a layout of something like this, where here is the reason and Paul's action, the content of Paul's prayer, followed by the purpose of Paul's prayer, followed underneath that by God's power as the motivation and the enablement to God's prayer, okay? This has a linguistic basis for each phrase. Now I'm tying all those together. There are a lot of other ways to do these kinds of grammatical and syntactical displays to understand how a text fits together. So that's another form of this, as well as discourse analysis, narrative analysis, which are slightly different things. Theological flow, book theology, and that's something that is a biblical theology thing that we've not done here because we'll do it there. Using tools, how to be successful with grammars, lexicons, word books, background books. The idea is something that tells you like the culture of the time. Actually, you kind of be careful with those kinds of books. I think in some ways they can be a bit misleading. And also translations, commentary, software. Here I'm looking forward to this. Mark Ward works for Logos Bible Software, but he will also kind of demo for us some of the other options, Accordance and BibleWorks. So what software exists and some of the good things that you can do there, some of the best choices to make. Exegetical fallacies. This is actually a book by D.A. Carson, but he lists a lot of things that people get wrong in their interpretation and how to avoid those. This will be more philosophical, but it'll be good. How do you put these pieces together? Application, how do you do contextualization, and how do you interpret a passage in your context specifically? Types of literature, narrative, poetry, philosophical, prophecy, how do you handle each one of those genres? New Testament use of the Old, this is a huge topic, but how do the texts relate to each other? Putting the disciplines back together, and what I ask the teacher to do here basically is take a text and with one text walk you all the way through from BT all the way through practical and context. So he's taking you through everything, the whole process. And similar thing here, kind of another form of that, but taking us a step by step through the entire exegetical process on several different texts. Specific praxis, these are hard passages. I just chose five really, really tough passages, okay? And these are the ones you hurt your head on. So I'm gonna ask teachers to take those on. And then a similar lecture to what we're doing today, okay? It's gonna be a very thorough class. It'll be a challenging class. It'll be good. It'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah, awesome. It's gonna stretch all of us, probably stretch the teachers too. But that's a good thing. Very good thing. Awesome. So please tell your friends that you know that would be part maybe in your Bible college that it was with you, maybe other faculty, that they would jump on this class. This next class is actually extremely significant. it is really the foundation of everything you're doing in seminary, because it becomes your hermeneutics, your exegesis becomes the baseline, the bedrock, moving forward into every other course. And it gives you that, gives you the skills you need. And probably the very reason that we have so much error where we do have error in our own theology, and of course in all the way to liberal theology, has a lot to do with our hermeneutics and our exegetical methodology and really the way we approach it. So this is a very important class and very significant to give our next generations to whom we're responsible for such great content. There's a question here that came in regarding methodology. Dr. Arnold, in my context, I would like to show that it's more than finding repeated words in the books. And I think you mentioned that in there. We have that where you're finding relevance beyond just beyond word count. I think I saw in one of those lectures, I could see that befitting in there, that idea. That's an exegetical fallacy, perhaps, that Carson would deal with even.
I think so. I mean, it really basically, good exegesis is good observation. And that's what we'll talk about, is all the kinds of things that you need to be watching for, and learning how to just be a good observer, just pick up on all kinds of things. You said something about good books I would recommend, and I pasted that in there. This is a book that just came out. It's really, really new. But I've been working with it. I actually got a chance to look at it a little bit ahead, and it's great. It's really good. I want to use this as a recommended textbook. So if you're interested in just one book, this is a really good one to go with. And I think it's practical, but it's academically sound. Really a good book.
I concur. I looked at it as well. Very good. And there's not a lot out there like this where you have these type of steps given to you, so laid out so well, so logically.
The question about the cost, it would be the same thing as this semester. It would just be the same. Basically $10 US equivalent for a majority world student, and $50 US equivalent for a minority world student. So same thing as this semester.
Okay, great. Exciting.
I don't know about you, Dr. Oberlin. I'm ready, really ready to jump into questions.
Yeah, me too. Let's do it. Why don't you take us there?
Okay. You guys have already seen, I hope, what I sent over, which was just the form of this for you to look at for your own use. And I will go ahead and open that up on my end and put that in here. But comment here first, just as I go by that. Great questions. Thank you. I thought the questions were good quality, and I appreciate the time that you guys have put into them, showing good thought, and that you've really worked at this class. So thank you for your effort. Thank you for your thought and your work on that. And I appreciate the quality of the questions that we have the privilege to discuss now. So I'm opening this up now here. And I don't know, Dr. Oberlin, we can jump back and forth here as we go, but the first question I'll read here. Someone asked the path for applying many things that we're seeing in this class. I'm excited with many topics that we have seen because I can see multiple relationships within the main themes of scripture. Some days I was thinking whether believers in my church would be excited to learn about topics like the Jesus, the Son of Man, the New Covenant, development of missions, Holy Spirit, and so forth. I know that application requires time and method, but I would like to connect how this fits the real life and how can I relate this to the needs of my brother. So anyway, Dr. Oberlin, you want to take a jump at this one, and then I can comment, we can keep on rolling.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a great question, very good question. There's a lot of things that come to mind, and I'm just going to break down them one by one, really. There is, and when I say this, I'm not critiquing the question itself, but I think there's an understanding that we have to come to realize that there is the application. If you cannot see the scripture holistically, like we're trying to show through this class, Advanced Biblical Theology, if you cannot understand how there is a creation, fall, redemption, consummation framework, or these big pictures of these themes, how they work through diachronically through scripture, you are going to really miss out on actually what the scripture is about. And one of the things that I'm really concerned about, even with this next generation, is that we don't just teach people Bible stories or we just teach them content disjointingly, but that we actually allow our children to understand that this is actually one story. This is what God is doing. And that any piece of information that I'm getting is actually, I'm inserting it into hooks that I've built that actually see it as one story. And if the Bible becomes disjointed, where we know this fact, but we can't see how it's put together. And that's really the emphasis of this course this semester, right? We're looking at diachronically. Don't just give me Daniel 7, but talk about Son of Man all the way through. How does that actually work? What's the theology of that? And that's part of a larger story of redemptive history. So if I can understand that, to the degree that I can understand that, I'm actually appreciating my Bible, and I'm actually it's actually a safeguard that I can actually, that I'm giving to myself, so that I can spot error even faster. Now, having said that, some of these themes that we're talking about, though, are extremely significant. The idea of Son of Man is no small theme. For example, this is Jesus Christ's favorite way to talk about himself. Jesus Christ talks about himself as Son of Man more than any other title, any other designation. So this is not like a minor topic. This is actually a major topic. And why is that? Well, it's because Jesus Christ is claiming to be the Danilic, that is the Daniel 7 Son of Man. And that, why is that so significant? Because he's connecting himself with everything, every prophecy of the Old Testament, that he says, I am actually the God-man. I am, the title Son of Man is not just like the converse of Son of God. The title Son of Man is actually this one who is a man who is you know, human, who is God, who's coming with the Ancient of the Days and the clouds of heaven. And so this is a theology of teaching that God's promises do relate, and that God is fulfilling his promises, and then everything is being fulfilled in actually Jesus Christ. And if you want to go to application, okay, now let's turn that to ourselves in 2017. How does that apply? Well, as general as God keeps his promises, what he said he will do in Daniel 7, he's done. And we're waiting the ultimate fulfillment where we see him reigning as king, not just simply in our hearts, but that we see him physically reigning as king 1,000 years and millennium, and then ultimately for eternity. And we're part of his kingdom. And he is the Daniel 7 Son of Man. He's the ruler over all the earth. Now, having said that, my last thought is this, that, you know, when we sit sometimes, let me just take us into the context of a church. You know, when we sit in a church service and we hear a preaching, a lot of times our thoughts can be, we all fall susceptible to this, the fact that our thoughts can be like, you know, how does this apply to me? But when we go to church, and particularly that's what the context of the question is going towards, because it's saying, okay, how can the people at church, you know, I'm taking this class on the side, but what about the people in the church? Okay, well, we actually need to teach our people this, that when they come to church, they're not looking to get something necessarily. Although I hope that people in churches get a lot. They get a lot of information. They understand all this data. But when we go to church as well, we are wanting to give. That we're wanting to ascribe unto the Lord certain things. We're wanting to praise his name. And sometimes worship is not just found in, oh, that's right, that applies to me, I need a change. But worship can just be just meditating and looking upon God and understanding God in a way that I've never understood God and appreciating that. And that alone is application for my life. I mean, think of the angels around the throne of heaven who describe holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of hosts. I mean, those angels, it has been said that each time they say holy, it's not the same. It's not because they're thinking of the same thing, but that in essence, throughout all eternity, they're understanding more and more of God, so that each time they say holy, you could argue that it's actually because there's a new realization. It's just not mundane people who are like reciting the rosary or, you know, saying some creed, but that these people are actually feeling it, that God alone is holy. There's no one else like him. And so holy are you. And as we learn in our churches, our people need to realize that it's not just merely how does God apply to me, but how can I adjust myself to God? And as I learn information that is sublime, that is phenomenal about God, I say, holy are you. And that's, oh, okay, wow, I just caught another glimpse. Or here's another glimpse, and I'm understanding what God is doing holistically through a diachronic method of advanced biblical theology, but I'm understanding how God, what God is doing holistically throughout all time. And this becomes a profound thing when I can actually read my Bible and not have to walk away with what did I get out of my Bible today, but actually read my Bible and realize I got to see God more. You see, the Beatitudes begin, blessed are the pure in heart. Well, I know they begin with earlier than that, but blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. We as believers have the opportunity to be able to see God in ways that someone else would just, like Rudolf Bultmann, would just want to exegete Pauline epistles and read them in the Greek one more time before he dies, as he said on his deathbed. So I'll leave it at that. Maybe if Joel, if you want to, Dr. Arnold, if you want to answer any more of that, maybe it's...
No, that's great. We should have an invitation. Very good. Excellent. Good stuff. And a blessing too. I would echo those things. I really, really like what he said about the idea of helping this generation see the story of the storyline of Scripture. And that's a major burden that I would share here. We've got to help our people be able to tell the story of Scripture. This is the grandest story in the world. How can they not know this story? And so if after 20 years of listening to my ministry, then you ask them, tell me the big picture of Scripture, and they come up blank, or they don't know how to fit the pieces together, that's really tragic, very tragic. So I think this is one of the big ideas that biblical theology brings us to. A couple things I'm going to skip over here, but I will note in the notes that I sent over to you, the idea that biblical theology is so tied in with exegesis. So many of these passages, you've got to know the biblical theology to handle the passage right. And even, just this last Sunday when I preached, I did not say this, nobody was aware of it, but what I was doing was biblical theology as I explained the passage. When I preached this last Tuesday night, I was relying on biblical theology again, okay? And on Friday or tomorrow, I have a class I'm doing, working through a passage in Ephesians. We will do biblical theology. I will never say the word biblical theology. No one will know we're doing it, but that's what I'm doing. So it becomes a very critical theme involved with what you're doing in your preaching. And the more you work with this, the more you'll discover you use it. I've preached specific sermons, and I pasted some of these in because I wanted you to get a sense of what this looks like or how this feels. But I've preached book sermons on Ephesians, Titus, Revelation, Mark, Daniel, 1 Peter, and I've preached these. It's not like I just preached these in academic context. I mean, 1 Peter, I preached that in Zambia, and it was in a context where it was a very country church. Really, it was in the province. It would be in the kind of the village way out there. It really was a very, very simple group of people, but we talked about the book of 1 Peter, and I was doing a biblical theology of 1 Peter. Nobody knew that. I didn't say that. I didn't use the word. But I explained to them, what does 1 Peter mean, right? So this is a thing that's broadly useful anywhere in any context. And if you can help people do that, it will help them. I pastored for maybe a little under a year. Well, it was about a year. It was 11 months at a church here in the Philippines. And it was, again, not an academic or a lot of professional churches, but this was the series we did. We did the series on big ideas. I didn't say biblical theology, I just called it big ideas. Idea one, God created the world and it was good, but sin marred it. Number two, man is created in God's image, so the image of God. Number three, what that means, explaining the idea of dominion, the kingdom of God idea. Sacrifice or substitute was the next idea. Dwelling with God was the next idea. Messiah was the next idea. So we did that on Wednesday nights for about 2 months. And again, I never told them biblical theology. I would take a theme and we would go from Genesis to Revelation and talk all the way through. They loved it. They really, really enjoyed seeing how one truth goes through the whole Bible. And again, this is a group of people that are really good people, but not, it's not, these are not people with master's degrees and, you know, professional type people. It's a very normal group of people that I was speaking to. So I would say it's extremely, extremely practical for ministry. And I find myself reaching for biblical theology all the time in contexts that are not academic contexts at all. They're just preaching contexts.
That's great. I have found myself saying many times before this class, just in the last several, really decade or so, that since I've taken biblical theology, in my doctoral work, Dr. Joel Arnold is all, we both had this. We had biblical theology. We had two semesters of advanced Old Testament theology and one semester of advanced New Testament theology. I can remember when I first started taking biblical theology, it just opened up my eyes. And I would say that even a decade or so ago, I would say that I use biblical theology every single day of my life. I mean, just the way I think about scripture, the way I approach scripture, the way I come at it. When I talk to somebody and counsel somebody on the sidewalk, said, hey, you know, pastor, what do you think about this? And I'll tell them, I'll be thinking through and just giving them information because I've been trained to think in a way to actually approach scripture. And I'll just go down through, okay, well, the scripture says four things about that. And I'll just kind of jump through those four passages and show how they all cohesively, ultimately, I'm wanting to give them a systematic conclusion, right? So I'm ultimately, then I'll take those four things and then I'll say, okay, well, then that points to this actually being the fact. And this is how you should go about doing that, or how the scripture would suggest that if it's not as poignant. So,
excellent. Are we ready to jump to the next one?
This
is great. We can sit here and go back and forth because things you say make me, but we'll go to the next question. I'll read this through quickly, not completely, but
you want to put it back up?
Yep. Here she comes. Oops. Are you seeing the Word document?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, preaching and sub-themes. Someone said, indisputable that the main theme of the Bible is Christ. Certainly Luke 24 and so forth. But the homiletical challenge, the preaching challenge, can be hard or crippling. How do you preach Christ from Genesis 6, the Nephilim, or the different proverbs, or parables like the bramble, or the Song of Solomon? How do you preach about Christ? And so the risk of biblical theology preaching, the comment would be, as an expository preacher, would you maybe skip over the less obviously Christocentric valleys to focus on the Christocentric summits? So the temptation might be to skip over all of the places in between because you want to get to this big idea at the end. And then I would say this is a separate question, so maybe we'll hold on to this a little bit and come back to it a little bit later. I would say my initial comment on this first question is that sometimes the theme of the whole Bible is Christ, but sometimes the direction or the connection to Christ is not so direct and obvious. So that I think where people maybe take, the Song of Solomon and they go a weird way with it because they want it to be about Christ, is maybe because they want to get to Christ in a way that is not actually what the passage is saying. Okay, so then you start looking for, this maybe is a symbol of Christ, this is a typology, and you start doing some funny things. Where I think actually a lot of these passages are talking about, or they connect to Christ, Christology, in a less, or a bigger picture way. And I'll say this with an illustration. My wife reading through the Bible, I don't know, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, she read through the Bible really quickly, like 2 months, really went through it very quickly. And she came to me and she said, when I got to Leviticus, I always before kind of stumbled and got bored. But for the first time reading it fast, I realized it just hit me how hard it is for a person to approach God, because God is holy. And how can a sinful human go to God? And so it made me just amazed and overwhelmed at my salvation, that it's so hard to go to and approach to a holy God, and yet Jesus made it possible. Okay, that's Christology. But to get there, you actually are looking at the entire book of Leviticus, the whole thing, and not just looking at one verse and trying to find a kind of a clever, sneaky way to make a symbolism or something to get there. So I would say, yes, the entire Bible is about Christ, but it's maybe not always directly a direct line to Christology. Let's say in terms of the Proverbs, I don't know that in a specific sermon, I might not directly discuss the connection to Christology when I'm talking about Proverbs. I may tell people, here is the thing, you know, a principle of something that you ought to do. And at the end, I might say, you're not going to be able to live this out apart from Jesus Christ. That would be the connection. But I don't particularly take that one proverb that's talking about the lazy man and the diligent man and say, like, Jesus is the diligent man or something. You know, Jesus is the one that helps you live wisely. At the end, is a part of an invitation, something along those lines. Dr. Oberlin, I'll hand it off to you.
Okay. I'm gonna put something in the comments here. Peter's working a little slow here. In the chat, let's see. I think this resource, and I just looked it up to find out how much it would be. This resource I'm putting on here is on Kindle is $2.99. And the title of the book is Beginning at Moses, Finding Christ in the Old Testament. And I would say this is extremely valuable and very shaping book. This is written by a professor from Bob Jones University. He got his PhD there, and he taught for about 27 years. And then he moved on. He was the president of another seminary, and now he's the academic dean of a third seminary. But he wrote this book in his office at Bob Jones during his office hours, Beginning at Moses, Finding Christ in the Old Testament. And I wrote a review on Amazon, pretty lengthy review on this book. And I find that this would be extremely helpful for you to kind of think through, to what degree should I see Christ as I read Scripture. It's $2.99 on Kindle. I think it's well worth your effort in going through that material. You could read my review, and I think you're going to get a lot of it, because I actually put a fairly lengthy review for an Amazon review. But I think I think if you just read it yourself, I think it would really be helpful.
What if you commented on this second question? I mean, it's part of this question, but I think it's maybe a slightly different idea. I can put it up again. He asked, I'm kind of dancing the line here between biblical theology and expository preaching, between key themes and homiletics, and I'm feeling like perhaps the two are not coterminous, they're not the same idea. So something like what Jesus preached may not necessarily be the ideal for how we preach, given his time and circumstances, or how Enoch, Noah, Isaiah, or Peter preached. So this much as we like to be as biblical as possible in our lives and ministry. So this kind of gets us into homiletics a little bit, but any comments that you want to make there about kind of our philosophy of preaching as it would derive from the examples of these biblical preachers?
Yeah, if I'm reading the question correctly, I'm hearing that it's saying, because of the examples that are given, it sounds like the writers saying that they don't see our preaching, these other people's actual sermons being legitimate. And I would concur. I think that's right. I don't think that biblical theology and our homiletics are necessarily coterminous or coextensive. But I think the biblical theology becomes the methodology that undergirds my homiletics. And I think that's true. That I want that my sermon is going to be true to Scripture to the degree that I'm using proper exegesis. And then between exegesis and my homiletics, I'm needing to be able to properly analyze that material. And biblical theology provides a framework. And really, biblical theology, I would say this is the part that I think is important for connection with. Let me just check these mics here. Biblical theology, where I think is significant with. Are you getting a little bit of feedback too?
I'm fine for me.
Yeah, okay. Biblical theology provides my people as I preach to them to think God's thoughts after him. And what I mean by that is it provides for us the content of biblical scripture and the proportions that biblical scripture are given. So I can actually preach through something, and I could really, I could go through a pericope, a particular passage, and I could preach through that passage, But I want to give attention to things, not just what God has said, but I want to try to, if I'm really just a proclaimer, if I'm really just a channel, a messenger of God's message to people, then I actually want to deliver the message in the same proportions that God himself does. And biblical theology helps me do that. Biblical theology can say, here's the Bible, and the Bible actually talks about it this many times. And I can actually give that much emphasis to it within the framework of Scripture itself. And I think that to that degree, I think biblical theology is actually extending into my homiletics and actually dictating my homiletics, which I think is a good thing. What comments do you have, Joel? Hey, Joel, your mic. Sorry.
I'm sorry. My bad. Okay, can you hear me now? Is that okay?
Yeah.
All right, great. One thought that came to my mind here was kind of a distinction between the expository organization of a sermon versus an expository method or expository philosophy, which is to say, sometimes I think a misnomer is, or a fallacy is the idea that good preaching has to be linear through a passage. You have to start at verse 1 and go down to verse 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so you go in the order of the passage, and that's the only way to do a good sermon. And I don't agree with that. In fact, I very strongly disagree with that. I think what we would, if as we come eventually, and it's on our curriculum, to come to some homiletics philosophy courses here, what we would argue is that there are lots of methods to organize a sermon in terms of communication, but that you have to have done your exegesis. You have to have understood the passage, and then you communicate that passage to people. So in that way, then I think what you're getting at here is right. Like, Jesus' method is not linear, that he takes an Old Testament passage and he walks through verse by verse. And we don't have to do that either. But I think we can see their philosophy, like let's say what Peter does. If you think about Peter's sermon, or if you look at Stephen's sermon, or even the other kerygma, the other preaching passages in Acts, they are doing biblical theology as a sermon method that Peter is piecing together in Acts 2. He's piecing together like four different texts to form a theological picture that he presents. I mean, it is a biblical theology sermon. And I would say Stephen's sermon a little after that is basically a biblical theology of the nation of Israel, demonstrating that they have consistently rejected the truth. It's a biblical theology sermon. So I think these, actually, we have some examples in Scripture that are very strongly like this, that are showing us a biblical theology method of preaching. And that's a completely valid way to do it. I would still call that an expository method. So, great. This is a good question, or both of these were good questions. Thank you. Are you satisfied with that, Dr. Oberlin? Let's go to the next one.
Yes, that's great.
Okay. I'll put this guy back up. And this is a longer question. I don't know that I can read through it all just for sake of time, but I'll try to summarize it a little bit here. So we're talking about in the New Testament, this idea of turning to the Gentiles. And so what about Christian Zionism today? What if 1948, this pivotal event, Israel gets a land, what if that turns out to be false, or the state of Israel ceases to exist? And if something happens, some with the nation of Israel, the modern state of Israel disappearing, wouldn't that bring into question the credibility of biblical prophecy? Would that not be a rather expensive gamble based on speculation? And they talk here about ultra-Orthodox Jews opposing the idea of a secular humanist state of Israel. So this all connected to the land covenant, even a lot of money being given to Christian Zionism and so forth. Would it be a proper spot response for us premillennialists who know Yahweh or Christ? Is this a good response because we know Jesus will rule the world someday? I think Dr. Oberlin, I think I started that last question. So if you want to take this one first and then we can go.
Okay. Well, actually, can you put that back up there? I was still finished reading that.
I'm sorry. Here it comes.
What is this? Are these your notes here at the bottom, or what's that at the very bottom?
Yeah, those are just things I put in there.
Okay. Yeah. I concur what you're saying. I think that we do need to be careful drawing a direct line between the modern nation. Is it possible that the modern, for example, is it possible that the modern nation goes out of existence as we know it? Would that shake our faith? I don't think so. I don't think it should any more than it than when Israel went into exile and has not had a nation and all the you know terrible things that's happened to that nation to begin with up to now. Could it be that the Lord tarries another 200 years and that you know the nation could come and go? I don't know that the prophecies are necessarily that a modern nation is what is significant. It's that God has a people. Those are his people. And where are those people today? And what is God doing with those people? And ultimately, what will God do with those people? I think it's no surprise to God that his people could be exiled. In fact, it's happened in Old Testament era, and God actually was part of that. And it would be no surprise if they were exiled again, if so to speak. It's not going to shake our faith, or I don't think it really makes us vulnerable theologically. I don't think it has to.
That's good. Yeah, I mean, that's the direction my mind would go with this too. I had a funny conversation with Dr. Collins, the one of the guys that taught us here. And I was asking him about how he views Israel. And he said, I don't really support the Israeli cause for theological reasons, just more for geopolitical ones. And I think that's for reasons of just politics or something, possibly, maybe, yes. But we ought to evaluate those questions on their own terms. But in terms of I'm a Christian, therefore I ought to support Israel, I don't know that I'm there really, because Israel is just another broken country. The God's view on geopolitics is really simple, and it's that the world is broken, the whole thing. Every country of this planet is broken, and that includes the modern state of Israel. It's a broken country. It's an unbelieving country that rejects God. So I don't feel that any kind of, as a Christian, I need to support them per se. In terms of justice and questions about, but I mean, how do you get into that, even trying to evaluate those questions? So I want to be careful about drawing a direct line between the modern state of Israel and eschatology. I want to argue that if the modern state went out of existence tomorrow, God is still in control. I want to argue that there is something going on here apologetically, and there's a, I don't remember who or what this was, but there was an apologetic question at some point, and the answer in this, you know, kind of famous interview was that the existence of the Jew is a powerful argument for the truth of God's word. And I think that's valid. I think the fact that there is a Jew today is really amazing, because if you think of past other nations, I mean, there's an Egypt, but they're probably not even ethnically the same. The other nations around Israel have kind of lost their ethnic distinctiveness, but there is still a Jew. That's really mind-blowing. So I think the existence of the Jew, yes. The existence of the modern state, no. The modern state might be part of God's fulfilling prophecy. It might go back out of existence, and there might be another 1,000 years, and then there will be an Israel again. And last, I would say, our eschatology as a pre-mill assumes that Israel will first lead the way in rebellion. They will make a deal with the Antichrist before they're converted. So I'm not really strongly in support. Yay, the modern state of Israel, this is tied up with Christianity. This is not. It's a broken country, and they will actually agree with the Antichrist before Israel will be saved. And that's a future thing that we're expecting. They're people, and so I want to be them saved. And they are people that God has made promises to. So I definitely want them to be saved. But it's fundamentally because they're human beings made in the image of God. And as far as the geopolitical questions, I kind of view Israel like I view other countries. It's a country, and they need to be just, and they need to do things right. Beyond that, I'm not sure as so much that I tie up my theology with the modern state of Israel. Any comments there, Dr. Oberlin, or I can go to the next one?
Yeah, I think I would say that I would concur, generally speaking, on that. I definitely agree with the idea that the modern state is not like that this is a representation of, you know, the Davidic kingdom coming, that so theologically I would not see, you know, this is not the Davidic throne. I think Christ has taken that and we're expecting something much more. And I think that's maybe what we can communicate with our people, that and explain what we mean by theologically. And then I think it kind of puts some, it puts some actual substance to that. And so, but is there a respect for the nation? Is there a respect for Jewish people? Is there a respect for God's people? Is there a respect for what God will ultimately do with his people? Romans 9:11. Absolutely. Absolutely. And those are the people that God has chosen and to accomplish and has given much to. So good.
That's good. Yeah. There's some fascinating books out there. I'll just say, I mean, that it's an amazing country. I have great, even just from a practical standpoint, I have great respect for them. They've done some amazing things. Yeah. And they've endured some incredible things. Yeah. Good. Okay. Excellent thoughts. Thank you. Let's jump here. We can go to the next one, which is a great practical theology question. It's not really, I would say, honestly, probably so much of a biblical theology question, but it's fine. It's a very good practical theology question. Polygamy, a very difficult, challenging issue in Christianity. I would say here a comment here. This reveals our contexts, because for many people in many parts of the world, where I grew up in the U.S., polygamy never entered my mind. It was just never something I never encountered as a problem to have to think through theologically. And the first time I hit this was when I spent time in Zambia or in other parts of Africa, where it's definitely a thing. And a common question that pastors struggle through. So it's a real thing. Some questions here about Solomon, and then practical things here. How do you judge or discipline in churches? Since you are going, probably in some places, some contexts, you're going to have a guy in the church who has multiple wives. So can that person take the role of a leader? Are we going to judge or discipline someone if they are taking a second wife? And so some people are saying that only a pastor should not have multiple wives and so forth. Okay, hard question. And this is a cross cultural thing. And so depending on what your context is, this may sound really weird or it may sound really common to you. Here is a paper I put in here, and it's a discussion I had, a paper on polygamy. It's not really long, but it goes issues. A couple of comments I would make about polygamy and thinking about it. Number one, polygamy less common than we think in the Bible. There are a handful of characters that did have multiple wives. But I think maybe our assumption is just everybody had multiple wives. And it's actually fewer than we think. It represents cultural accommodation. What I mean by that, if I think of the American context, you have American believers that still watch popular movies that have very, very, very wicked elements in them. And I think it's as part of my own home context. It's very accommodationist. We're seeing there's this human tendency to just wrap up sin and culture into your own Christianity. Okay, that's the way Americans express their method of wrong thinking. This is in that period, Abrahamic patriarchal period, they were wrapping up their culture into something that was actually not right. And it is clearly condemned. You look at the paper, I've got some discussion there. You do have laws in the Old Testament law that kind of govern polygamy. It is not because God accepts polygamy as a possibility. It's Matthew 19:8, where the hardness of your hearts kind of thing. Basically, it's kind of like if God says, if someone murders, here's how to deal with them. That doesn't mean God is in favor of murder. I see a similar thing is happening with some of these passages. It's the recognition that in the broken society, some people will take multiple wives. And God's telling them, so I'm going to control that so that there is some justice. Practical theology, clearly a leader of a church, and I think you have to hold to that. As far as how you work that out in your practical context, this is not you're going to have situations where you've got guys there that have multiple wives. You cannot tell them to abandon those women and leave them on the streets. I would say their choice in the past, maybe while they were an unbeliever or before they came to your church, that choice they made requires them morally to take care of that person, because they can't just dump that woman and her children away. On the other hand, I think it would be probably a good application for you to tell them they need to be having a physical relationship with just one woman and not these, all of these. That's probably also a valid application to make, but you're going to have to work through that. Probably not. You can't really let a guy who has more than one wife be a leader in the church, pastor, elder, deacon. Okay, Dr. Urban, you've worked a lot more in this kind of field. These questions, any comments?
Yeah, the one thing that would just come to mind right away is I'd want to be really careful telling someone, you know, who came into a situation like that to immediately divorce all their wives, because what I don't want to do on that, practically on the other end, is I also don't want to promote divorce. And I think sometimes by trying to do what I think is a scriptural position or where we should be today in this era, that I could actually hurt the cause by just saying, well, you know, divorce is an option. And whereas I think probably the scripture speaks really negatively against the idea of putting away your wife. And if you've made a commitment to that woman or these ladies, that actually is not necessarily should be the knee jerk reaction. And I think probably some of you men who are dealing with this in your own ministry or dealing and working with people like this, I think probably you're not having that knee jerk reaction. But sometimes people from the West that would come to a situation like that might initially say, well, this is obvious. I mean, obviously you just divorced all these women. The first one you married was the one that's supposed to be yours. I think you have to be really careful and use caution on that, because there are responsibilities that you have made. There's a commitment you have made, and we don't want to minimize what marriage actually is. We don't want to minimize by just saying, well, then you can just divorce. So that's one idea I just throw out. And there is another one another idea I had on this, because when I lived in Asia, I was thinking a lot more about this, and I'm trying to remember what one scripture passage that was really helpful for me. I haven't thought about this probably in several years. And actually I didn't see this particular question ahead of time, so I apologize on that, but that passage will come to me here in a moment.
Okay. Yeah, we can come back to that. Excellent. And I think, I don't remember the details, but I think this may have been the same person writing kind of a related question. So will an adulterous person inherit the kingdom of God, or how would we put these together? Matthew 5, you shall not look on a woman if you look on a woman to lust after her, you've committed adultery with her in his heart. But 1 Corinthians 6, the unrighteous and adulterous will not inherit the kingdom of God. So the argument would be there, we are all adulterers in that sense. Any person who's ever at any point in their life looked on a woman to lust after her ever is an adulterer. So how could anyone then be saved and inherit eternal life? And then some other related passages like Hosea and so forth. I think, Dr. Oberlin, it's your turn to jump into something first, and then we can build on that. Sorry, we lost you on the audio.
Sorry, can you put that back up there? I was actually muting some sound effects here on my phone. Okay, thank you. So, how do we explain the passages? Can anyone leave with a perfect life without any evil thinking? We see in Old Testament, did God tell to Hosea to get married with harlot as his wife? What was God trying to do there? What was actually happening in that passage? Is that the main question here? That Hosea, God is ultimately theologically doing teaching his people, his prophets. He has them do many things that seem shocking, and this one is actually a great picture for actually what God's trying to teach his people. And I would just, you know, say that God is actually doing something through the situation itself that he's trying to teach his people. And we see this elsewhere in scripture where God does this. He's using his prophets to do things that actually are. I'm not quite sure what the problem with the question is. Did he tell him to get married with a harlot as his wife? I'm not sure. Is it an interpretation issue, or is it you're shocked that he married a harlot, or what is exactly the question?
I may be missing it myself. I was feeling that maybe it's the linkage of these two passages, the Matthew 5 to say, if you look on a woman, you've lusted, with 1 Corinthians 6 to say an adulterer will not inherit the kingdom of God, meaning none of us will inherit the kingdom of God. And I think I would probably go after this with two things. One would be to say, it's excellent thoughts here. One would be to say, Christ's point in Matthew 5 is, I think, exactly that. I mean, I think if you finish reading Matthew 5 and you say, wow, nobody can be saved, nobody can make it to heaven, Jesus says, yes. Because Matthew 5:48, you shall therefore be perfect even as your heavenly Father is perfect. In other words, for you to merit salvation is going to require you to be without sin, including not just external, but he's confronting an idea that someone says, well, I've never actually committed adultery, so I'm okay. And he says, no, this also has to do with your heart. So you've done it thousands of times in your heart. It's not just the act, it's your heart. So basically the conclusion of Matthew 5 would be, we are all condemned. But the answer to that would be the end of Matthew. It would be the death of Jesus Christ and the story of the New Testament, that we are all in bad shape. We are all condemned. And this would be the 1 Corinthians 6 idea coming here. What's the flow of the passage right after this? Right after 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11, none of these will inherit eternal life, but you are washed, you are justified, you are sanctified by the Spirit of our God. So the argument, the flow of thought in 1 Corinthians 6 is exactly this. You are all in trouble, but you are all washed. You are all made clean. The cross cleanses you from these things. And then one more idea that is still valid to say here in 1 Corinthians 6 is kind of a 1 John idea. I pasted that in here below if you want to take a look at it. This is from another document I have. But it's the idea in 1 John that if you're characterized by a certain thing, that actually shows that you have not been washed, you have not been justified, you have not been sanctified. Because if you're living in characterized by adultery, then that tells you something's wrong. So a person that continues to be characterized by this kind of looking and committing adultery in their heart, that tells us that person probably has not been washed, justified, and sanctified, and would raise questions for us then if, are they going to be a person who will inherit the kingdom of God? So these passages can go together. We can link these. There's not a problem here if we understand in a deep way what's going on in the structure of their logic.
That's great. Sounds great.
Okay. Maybe I will go to the next one then. Why did God choose failing man? Okay, so why does God desire to work through or with man? God has perfect foreknowledge. He knows man is frail. We're fickle. He knows how proud and selfish we are. Why would God create man, see him fall, work through a single man, Abraham, who is barren? Why then would he allow them to go into this land of an enemy, Egypt, and then rescue them through Moses, and then almost destroy Egypt in the process? And God's people fall into sin, and God sends his servants to get them on track, but they fall again, repetitive rebellion, repentance, reconciliation, the cycle continues. In other words, all these things, why didn't God hear the kind of closing question? Why couldn't God have chosen another man, another nation who would have obeyed him in the first place? You have this constant repetitive thing going on in the judges, falling. Why did God choose to go through it that way? So Dr. Oberlin, you can open that up or either way. Yeah. But if
You know, it's interesting because scripture does give us answers to this at a local level in certain contexts. So I think the ultimate question you want to know is like, okay, why is God doing anything in the universe? Well, the very definition of God is that we probably would not be able to know that, right? Because God makes decisions. So, but what God does provide for us, so if I had like an umbrella of like the biggest picture universal questions, why does God do anything? I can't know that because I think that's because he's God. What he does though is within, underneath that umbrella, there's smaller umbrellas, there's smaller subject matters that he does give us a window into that. His purpose, for instance, our election before the foundation of the world, that he might make holy and blameless before him. Or, you know, somebody mentioned Pharaoh in Egypt there in that question. Well, he actually tells us within context that he raised up Pharaoh for this purpose, or he actually has this particular person, you know, he wants to show his glory among the nations. He's doing something with this particular nation. So why did God, you know, raise up this nation, or why did God use Egypt this particular way? Well, he tells us those questions. So what God does is he gives us a lot of answers to why at a smaller levels, which ultimately kind of give us a framework for the bigger level, but we don't ultimately know. I mean, the greatest thing, of course, is that we are created for his glory, and we know God ultimately is doing this for his glory. But even beyond that, what is the biggest picture and how does that work itself out? I think it's the definition of God. I think, I mean, not the definition, but it is an aspect that explains what it is to be God, that God is God and he can do what he wants. And no, you know, like Daniel says, and no one can stay his hand or say, why are you doing this? I mean, this is exactly what God said to Job. He says, you know, were you there when I created things? And nobody was there. Nobody was around to ask questions or make suggestions. And that, I think, is the point, that he is supreme over all. So we do have answers, but the answers I think God gives to us are at the lower levels.
That's excellent. Yeah, I mean, there's a passage that does this exact line of thought, and it explores some of these questions. It asks a question like, is it right for God to create someone and then for him to have purposes for them later, and that those purposes may not be positive? And it's Romans 9 through 11, and it's exploring some of these questions, and it asks some of these hard questions. If you get down to the end of 11, and it ends out all the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Who has known the mind of the Lord? Who has been his counselor? Who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? From him, through him, to him are all things, to him be glory forever. So I think what Dr. Oberlin just said really totally nails it. It's, you hit a point where you just don't know. You really don't know. And you have to be okay with that. I would say why questions probably, there's three things I'll hit here real quick with this. Why questions are ultimately impossible to answer. We can try, but there's, you know, why did this happen this way or so forth? We just get stuck. And so you just only can say so much with a why question. Three other ideas that fit in here. One, do think of the contrary. Had God chosen Abraham and Israel, and then they just did a tremendously wonderful job, and the whole world was transformed by Israel, there is sort of this feeling you lose. It's kind of this sense that, weren't they great? You know, wasn't David great, and wasn't Solomon great, and weren't they just did a great job? Versus, I think, what the picture of the Bible is presenting to us, everybody fails until Jesus comes. So I think there's something there. I really think there is something there that's pretty critical. I'm not gonna pretend that I know how to put all those pieces together apologetically, because we're essentially asking a problem of evil question. That's essentially at the core what we're asking. But I think there would be something we lost had everybody done a great job. It probably highlights the significance of Christ's coming in salvation history. A Titus 3:4 concept, if you look at the logic of Titus 3, or it's an Ephesians 2 concept too, we were all a mess, we were all falling apart, everything was really, really in bad shape, but grace appeared, God appeared, salvation appeared. So I think it probably highlights that idea. And then lastly, I would say there's a similar question going on here with the 2,000-year delay for the church that happens in 2 Peter 3. Kind of the question, had Jesus returned in the year 1500, we could have avoided this whole World War II thing, this whole atomic bomb thing could not have happened, the Holocaust could not have happened. You know, you get into those kinds of questions, and we're essentially dealing with a problem of evil question. I don't know that you so much can go there. But I think Peter would say to you, his answer would be, God has done this out of mercy because he gave you a chance to repent. He gave me a chance to repent. He gave me an opportunity to come to salvation. I think that's the logic. And that's about as far as the biblical story is going to take us in answering the question. It's a hard question.
Yeah, I just was thinking of this passage in John 9 that, you know, this man's born blind. His disciples say, you know, who sinned, his parents or him, that he was born blind? And Jesus said, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. So this guy's like 40 years old when he gets healed. But think about that. He basically lived on the planet for 40 years so that the works of God would be displayed in him. I think there's some application for that even for ourselves to realize that, you know, God has a plan and God is doing things for his glory. But also, so at a lower level, this actually gives us a purpose. It gives us a design. It gives us a plan. But I don't think as the higher we go, the less that we're going to be given.
That's good. That's really good. Okay, maybe I'll read this one and then if you want, you can take this one. Or jump into this one. What would you say is the overall truth statement of Scripture? I certainly agree that Jesus Christ is the center of theology. His person and work best explain the difference between the testaments. But when I think of a theme, I'm thinking of a statement, subject and predicate, maybe communicating to people. So instead of just say Jesus Christ, maybe Jesus is the Christ, Savior, Sovereign. But are we covering the overall message of the Bible? Is that a biblical theology study? Maybe the Bible is intended to communicate an overall message. And so that's why scholars have lots of different views, just like different expositors can come from different angles on the same text. So maybe it would be legitimate also for statements of the overall message of Scripture. What would we say is the overall message statement of Scripture?
Is it my turn?
Either way, if you want to take it first. Or...
Well, this is your lecture, so why don't you address it first? Because you.
Yeah. Okay. So, I guess I would say something like this. I do think there are probably a lot of answers, possible answers to the question. In other words, I used a very specific word, center, and I felt like if you said center, then the answer would be objectively Jesus Christ. It didn't say theme per se. And I think one of the reasons for that, if you ask the word theme, then go back to the lecture we have there. There are like five different things that you might mean by using the word theme. So I think maybe the reason scholars come with lots of different answers is because they're using theme in a different way. I do also think maybe when we're talking about the core message, he used a different word here, message over message. I think maybe we can think of it a little bit like, think of Google Maps. Okay, when you zoom in on Google Maps, pay close attention, it's kind of interesting. It's not just that things get bigger or that they expand as they go. Things actually disappear. In other words, if you zoom in way, way, way on my house, you'll see details about the buildings around my house. But if you zoom out on Metro Manila, they're not showing labels for every building. So the closer you come in, there are things that fall away because the further you go out, you just can't put that much detail there. Okay, I think that about the message of the Bible too. If you're gonna zoom in and someone says to me, give me the message of the Bible in like four words or something, I just don't have time to say a lot of things. If you say, give me the whole message of the Bible, leave nothing out, then my answer is, excuse me, I'll go get my Bible and I'll hand you my Bible. Right? I mean, because if I'm going to leave nothing out, I'll just give you the Bible. And if you give me, you know, 500 pages, then I can write 500 pages about the message of the Bible. I really think it's about how much you're going to say. Do you want a sentence? Do you want a paragraph? Do you want five words? And it's really more about what we're asking with that. I'll end with this kind of idea. I do think that it's possible, while there can be multiple ways of expressing it, I think there are some right possible answers and there are some wrong possible answers. And I think we all ought to agree on that. I mean, I think we all can agree that Peter is not the theme of the Bible. That's a wrong answer, right? So I think we all agree there. And therefore there's probably a set of like maybe even three or four or fewer ideas that are actually legitimate candidates for the theme of the Bible. And I still feel pretty strongly personally that among those, Jesus Christ, if you're just going to give me like two or three words, that's my best shot. if you want to expand this out into a sentence, I'd say take a look at the different things I sent before. I sent some in that document in that lecture, and there's some sentences there, and those are good. So I'm perfectly okay with something like that if you want to expand it out into a sentence.
Yeah, you know, I like the theme. I like the idea of Jesus Christ as center. I felt like your argumentation was really good. What I felt like would actually undergirds that, maybe for me at least, I felt like it was most helpful just to think of the fact that Jesus Christ is the origin of all things, and Jesus Christ is creator, and the very fact that he's the creator would expect for him to be the center. Because it's all the DNA, the blueprint, the framework of it, it's all from him. And so it have to do everything with what his design is, what he would want to accomplish, and it would all come back to him. So there's passages like this. It's from him, through him, and all back to him. So the expectation's there for him to definitely be the center. And as far as a theme, he has to have something to do with that theme.
That's great. I'm just looking for it, and I'm not seeing it right now, but I'll find it in a little bit. And I'll paste over, here we go. Some of the options that are pretty good as a sentence form. And you could work with some of these if you wanted, but here they come. So these are sentence statements of the various possibilities of themes. The disadvantage is just once you get a little bit longer, it's a little harder to remember. So it's a lot of it has to do with who you're trying to communicate to people, or what you're trying to say to people. And the more compact you are, the easier time they'll have remembering what you were saying. It's about that complicated.
And there are themes that are like really expansive, right? Like the theme of kingdom, you're going to find all the way through the scripture, even the idea of dominion way back in the beginning, Genesis 1. And you're going to find that at the very end, that is Jesus' dominion. So the theme of kingdom I've been attracted to for many years, but so the, you know, I like what, you know, this idea of God reigns, saves, and satisfies through covenant for his glory in Christ. But I think kingdom has a key aspect as well. Sorry, I think I cut you off.
No, you didn't at all. I like that definition too. I would say actually what's here, this last sentence in the chat, God reigns, saves, and satisfies through covenant for his glory in Christ, is really sharp. The one word I'm not super crazy about, the satisfies, I feel like the guys who are working with this are great guys. I really like them. But they're working in one context where the satisfies part of it, I think, probably is a kind of a keynote emphasis of that ministry. And so I think that might be why that's there. And I want to feel it more in the direction, instead of satisfy, something like worship or something in that direction. But you've got for his glory, so maybe that's covering worship. Anyway, that word satisfies, I've struggled with that a little bit. Is that really nailing biblical data, or is that more a reflection of that particular ministry's emphasis? But anyway, I don't know. It's a good thing. I'll go to the next one, and we can keep on rolling here. Okay, so here we go. Should we divide over different approaches? With all the different approaches to biblical theology interpretation, whether covenant, dispensational, progressive, dispensational, if we consider in the end that God will save only those that are truly his own people, is there a need to divide over matters like these? Evidently, God in his wisdom chose not to reveal everything. There will be different interpretations. Should not the focus of his people then be more on application, literally doing what he commanded to fulfill the commandments, and to bring his kingdom to the earth. Are we barking up the wrong tree? Actually, you discussed this, Dr. Oberlin, last lecture as well. I think that was in the notes. So anyway, what thoughts or comments would you have there?
Beyond what I just said previously, I would just say that, yeah, a lot of times we can be focusing too much on things that don't necessarily matter. But there's also things that do matter that we need to focus on. And I think you just have to know the levels. You know, sometimes people put it in three boxes. They'll say there's actually the core fundamentals of the faith. And I'm not reading through the question again, but to the degree that this is answering it, I'm just trying to answer it a different way than what I did. There's the core fundamentals of the faith. And then there's a second category that maybe I can have fellowship maybe denominationally or over certain, you know, ideas. And then there's these more tangential things that are not as significant matters. So you can actually maybe group things within categories. There are things that are actually doctrinal matters that yes, there's separation. These are fundamental truths. These are things I would die for. These are things I'm giving these are things I believe they shape my whole thinking. And then there's other things that, you know, I can have fellowship with somebody. If I'm covenant in my theology and I baptize my children, you know, infants for bringing them into covenant. And then you have this other guy who's a Baptist. They should be able to fellowship with each other if they have agreement over here. They should be able to fellowship with each other. But there is a sense where it might look different. The fellowship, they might not be able to fellowship at the ecclesiological level, like within the same church or the same worship group. And that's okay, maybe. And maybe they can. Maybe there's some context where they should. And they need to, just based upon they're the only believers around. And, you know, sometimes we can get, you know, when you go to places that are really full of believers in churches, we can get a little bit too choosy and picky sometimes as well. And I think we need to be careful of that. But then we can move into other things where these are preferences or even fences or standards that we put in our life to really help us become more holy and really facilitate what we're trying to do as we worship the Lord. But they're not necessarily things that everybody should follow, and people can do things differently in faith. And that's okay. And so I think if we understand that there are different buckets within a continuum of things that are actually doctrinally fundamentals all the way to my preference, then I think that really helps me give perspective to, okay, who is this brother and where do they fall and what should I be doing with that?
That's good. That's good. Yeah, I'm not much to add there. I think the question that you asked, you're right. The person who asked this, I think you're right on here with, is there a need to divide over matters such as these? Not really. I mean, in general, the difference between so long as they're not like hyper dispensationalist or hyper covenantal, no, you don't need to generally divide over these things. Infant baptism bothers me, but I don't. Generally, we don't have to divide or treat a person like an enemy over one of these kinds of areas. I do think I want to say there are versions or parts of this discussion that do make a big difference on your interpretations of passages, and that's where probably you will feel this. So if you look at Schreiner on Revelation, I like Schreiner, and we chose him as our textbook. But Brother John Glass and I were discussing him on Revelation. He's just not helpful. I mean, I wouldn't mind if we just cut that chapter out of the book. I read it and I didn't feel like I got much benefit from it at all. So I think Revelation could be much, much, much stronger. But the reason his interpretation goes that way is because of his viewpoint. So it does make a difference. Basically, the way I preach an entire book, it's a big deal. And it's not just within kind of like a scholarly academic thing that we're batting this around. It really makes a big difference. So I think we've got to maintain those things and some of the differences then between covenant and dispensational approaches, they matter.
Yeah.
On the other hand, do I divide from those people? Of course not. I mean, one of my best friends in college was a Presbyterian and we had very different views on this. That was okay. So That's the side of it, but these things still matter. It's not just ideas that exist in seminary. It makes a difference. It can make a big difference.
Yeah. So the division is not necessarily at the same level of division, but there's always practical division, right? There's a reason why you chose the church you chose versus another church, if there's another option. And there's a reason why you ultimately separate, as in biblical separation, with somebody. And there's a reason why maybe you don't want your children playing with another group of children. And that has, it's a totally third thing. It's not even, but yet there's a practical division. And that can be the case.
Good. Okay. We'll keep on going this far, or go to the next here. So I'll read this here and then I'll hand this to you, Dr. Oberlin. A general question regarding biblical theology, how it is often presented. So you hear sometimes the seed to tree analogy, that maybe the seed is planted, and then as this is a progressive development idea, the seed in Genesis growing into the fullness of the tree, you know, all the way to Revelation. So just as a seed has all the elements of a tree in germ form and becomes a tree through the development, so biblical theology traces the various development of ideas from seed to full development. My problem is that all the elements of a truth are present in the beginning of the canon, is the idea that all would be, just in seed form. But is that really accurate? Is it really that all the ideas or the elements are there? Isn't progressive revelation more like a blurry picture coming into focus, or doing a puzzle during which you add more and more pieces? So preaching a message tracing progressive revelation, would you try to show gradual growth or gradual addition? There's a slight distinction there. It's good. Related question, would you divide scripture into different eras? How many? New Testament, one era, two, three, four. What about Bernard's idea of seeing so much progression within the New Testament canon? A lot there.
I think the writer has a good point. I think that there is to say that the Genesis 3:15 has the framework to say that everything is in that verse, the entire gospel is in that verse. I don't think that that's what we mean when we say the DNA is there, but I think we're saying the framework is there, which the details do grow. Progressive revelation does grow in its details. Gradual growth of addition, gradual addition. I think, yeah, it's obviously there's gradual addition. So I think it's a good question. I think there's a good point being made here, and of how there is a progress of doctrine, even in addition.
Yeah, no, I agree. I kind of felt like my preferred, of the metaphors he gave, which I liked, my preferred one was the puzzle piece, adding more and more pieces, because I do think that's true. I mean, are you really seeing the cross with all of its implications about someone being a replacement for you, someone standing in your place? Are you seeing that in Genesis 3:15? No, I mean, you have that he will crush, his heel will be bruised, but nothing about imputation or something going on there. I mean, there's a lot of pieces that get added, and then maybe some of those pieces are like the blurry picture coming into focus. There's multiple metaphors you can use here. Probably the seed, the tree one may not be exactly the best one. You can get a little technical with this. Some things do grow genetically, to use an Old Testament theology term. I use this idea. Others are individual ideas that are being added wholesale. And then, what do you think, Dr. Oberlin, here, the last part, a related question, how would you divide the scripture into different eras? You know, you kind of have the dispensationalist, you know, seven, but more like the progressive dispensationalists are going to talk about three, four, basically three. How would you kind of divide things up, or how does that strike you?
Well, I guess I just would want to make sure I have the major divisions the scripture has. There's the, there's something going on prior to the fall. There's something going on after the fall. Up to the time of the cross, and there's something going on after the cross till Christ's return, and so forth. So, I mean, those are major divisions everybody has to agree on. And I think it's a beautiful thing, and it's a wonderful thing that we all can agree on those, no matter what system you're coming from. So I'm really excited about those particular divisions that I think Scripture is very clear on. Making a lot of, about like trying to trace out seven dispensations, you know, and looking at this and, you know, coming up with this framework, because they all have, you know, they all start with this way and then they all end this way. And that, and these are the, you know, I think that's helpful. It's helpful to look at Scripture a lot of different ways, but that's not really as important to me as it's not as significant as what's actually going, what are the divisions that, you know, we are all agreeing on. What has really also helped me is just thinking through the already not yet principles and really having an appreciation for that as well. And I think as I don't want to just diss or, you know, just kind of throw out, you know, these former dispensational systems, because they're looking at truth, but at the same time, that's not my framework. I don't really go think, oh, there's these seven dispensations or these five dispensations. I like seeing the framework of there's something before the fall, there's something from the fall to the cross, and and God was actually covering things, God was overlooking things. Now we're being washed, the cross has happened, we're washed, and we're waiting their return. And we're enjoying this new covenant, the new covenant benefits that God has inaugurated in the cross, and we're looking forward. So, I'm sure there's probably we'd differ, as many people as we have here on the forum, I think we'd probably differ in how we all split that up. But I think what we can enjoy are these divisions that are very clear for everybody.
Yeah, right. Yeah. The seven thing, the old classic dispensationalism, the seven thing is a little annoying to me because it implies that all of the different sections are equally significant. In other words, like the Noahic era is as significant as the church age. And I'm thinking, really? I guess what I would say is it's kind of like the system got just way too complicated and way too developed until you kind of forgot about really, you wanted seven things and they all had to work the same way. And it just got too structured, way too structured. I would prefer to think of the divisions of Scripture kind of like if I ask myself, how is humanity divided up? Well, there's a lot of ways to do it. You can say there are this many countries in the world, but then if you want to go into a country, then every country is broken into provinces, and then some of those provinces are bigger, some are smaller, and then within those provinces, there's towns. Or you can talk about different, you can talk about different characteristics, this kind of culture, or financial. You can talk about GDP across different countries. There's a lot of ways to organize things. As I think about Scripture, there are some really big, huge eras that are obvious. Okay, everything before Christ, the Old Testament, New Testament, that's just the most basic fundamental. And the same thing with the Garden of Eden, that's a very fundamental thing. We should all definitely agree. Then you can get in and you can start talking about the millennium. That can be broken off as a separate. The tribulation comes before that. So you have it. And then you can talk about during the life of Christ. You can talk about the little period, if you want, between Jesus' death and the coming of the Spirit. I mean, you can get into some really detailed stuff if you want. But those really detailed eras are probably not that significant, honestly, for your exegesis. You want to pay attention to the really big ones and then not put as much time into the smaller level things. And I'll just jump over this really quick. Bernard seeing so much progression within the New Testament canon, I think maybe he's outstating it a little bit overly much sometimes, because I think in his context, it's kind of still a little bit of evolutions of religion era. And so it's kind of the assumption that as time went on, religion made progress and got better. I don't think he believed that, but I think the people he was speaking to did. And so he kind of had to tip his hat. And I think that might be what this question, the person who asked this, is picking up on. Some of his statements feel a little uncomfortable because it's kind of implying Paul's theology is more advanced somehow than the early theology in Acts. It's not more advanced. It's just building progressively on the truth, more revelation, but it's not like it's 2017 versus 1980 or something. It's not like technology or something advancing and getting better. So there's something going on there that we're probably not comfortable with. That good, Dr. Oberman? Anything else you want to say there?
That's great.
We've got Children of the Serpent versus the Woman. In the main text of the Course of the King and His Beauty, he talks about the children of the serpent versus the children of the woman. So it's kind of this, the seed of the woman, the seed of the children idea. And considering his reformed views on election, this seems to be a big building block. Is there a grounds to see this outside of a reformed perspective? If you're not reformed like him, then should you have this idea or should it bother you? It might become a lens through which we view people, both in biblical history and in church history, or worse, in contemporary times. So we may start asking, is that a child of the serpent or a child of the woman? Then, after all, we are looking at people through that, taken to its logical conclusion, a division of humanity into an us versus them that the Bible doesn't really support. I don't remember who went first last time. I can take it or you can take it. I don't care. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, well, I think I like his observation. I mean, I think the latter danger, I appreciate. I'm appreciating that. That's true. I don't want to go around saying, is this the seed of the serpent or is this the seed of the woman? That would be, you know, you walk through the grocery store or the market and you're asking, you know, who's the seed of it? But there, you know, obviously there are going to be those that are his and those that are not his. And what scripture does is it scripture teaches us very early on that you are not, that you don't, just because you're within a certain lineage or a certain people, that does not limit you, that God's grace crosses over, right? Rahab, Ruth, Uriah the Hittite. I mean, the guy's a general in David's army or leader. And the scripture keeps reminding us that it's not, his last name's not Hittite. It just keeps reminding us, though, that that's what he was. So, you know, I think that this, you know, you keep going over through the scripture over and over again. Scripture says, hey, look, God's going to call people from every tribe, tongue, nation. I mean, that's what's going on. And that's what the scripture has provided for us, that hope and that acknowledgement. And that really gives us a motivation for missions. That there are people out there that they don't even know it, but they are prepared. They're being prepared as worshipers of our God for all eternity, and we're gonna join in together.
That's good. You may see here the notes I put below. I think probably the core distinction here that helps us is the recognition that God does talk about his people, but it's after they're saved. You don't really have a, like, this was one of, this is, you know, these are my people, but, or this person, this individual is my person. This person belongs to me, and they're part of the seed of the woman, but they're in rebellion against God. I don't think you get that idea. I don't think I could support that idea effectively. What you do have is this idea, you were in the kingdom of darkness, but God transferred you to the kingdom of his son. You were under the dominion of Satan, but God delivered you. So that I was, for the first 8 years of my life, part of the seed of the serpent. And then subsequently, I have been part of the seed of the woman, or, you know, best to say, I am in Jesus Christ. I am united with Christ. But that's only since I trusted in him. And in that sense, once you get there, then, okay, this idea works now, or this idea won't be bothersome to us like that. There is a certain us-them idea in the Bible, and I think it's pretty striking if you think of the world, that when you have this, the world used in its ethical sense, as in love not the world kind of idea, what it's saying to you is don't love, like, the entire planet, with the assumption that the entire planet, basically, almost the entire planet is under the dominion of Satan, an Ephesians 2 idea. The whole planet is just following him into destruction. The planet is messed up. Don't love that. So there is a sense in which I am a sojourner and an exile. I stick out. I really don't fit. And I have to be different in that sense. But the idea that I think what you're saying, you're picking up on a legitimate concern, which would be, I don't want to look at this person who is still part of that world system and say, well, he's part of the seed of the woman. He's not yet. If he hasn't trusted in Jesus Christ, he's not yet. It's kind of a before after thing that we're looking at. The idea of election, it's there. So I've got to be honest to biblical data. I mean, it's there, and there are these expressions like that as many as were elect believed in Jesus Christ. So I've got some of those expressions that are a little bit crossover expressions, and I've got to struggle with those. I've got to be honest to what they say. I should not try to nullify them. But yeah, I think you've got something here that maybe the way Schreiner's saying is a little overstated a bit. Okay. Yeah, American politics is definitely, yeah, and I can't go down that track. It's just, the polarization is ridiculous. We can go to the next one, and we're almost there, really. So if we do this, we will finish all of our questions tonight, which will be fantastic. If Christ is the fulfillment of the Adamic covenant, Abrahamic, Mosaic, Davidic, all the promises in the Old Testament have their fulfillment. This creates an obvious discontinuity between the Testaments, but this raises a question about land. If Christ is the fulfillment, then did he fulfill the promises even in regard to the land, so that those promises are fulfilled? Therefore, we don't need to literally look for a millennial temple with sacrifices and so forth. And last, does this any of this matter? So between covenantal and dispensational camps, one thing is clear, there's no simple answer to them. And why ask the questions then? In the end, neither side has really argued convincingly. And so we kind of end up arguing about something that has not only happened, but kind of a tempest in a teapot. Even if we lean to a dispensational viewpoint with Christ ruling and so forth, beyond that, arguments about the land, the temple, the Jewish character are not really knowable to us today. Kind of like an Old Testament believer probably would not have been able to figure out all the details about Jesus coming and so forth. Maybe I'll jump here and then hand it over to you, Dr. Oberlin. I agree with a lot of what you're saying here. So there is some discussion here. As far as the land, I want to be careful there. I don't want to say just the land is a fulfilled thing because he did promise it. The language is really, it has to be fulfilled to those people. And yet, you know, I can see what you're saying, but I do think it has to be fulfilled to those people. But I think you're right when you get into some of these details. As far as I look at, I don't know what my conclusion is in regard to the temple. Ezekiel 40 to 48, I don't know quite how that fits. I don't know how to put that together in the details with the new Jerusalem. And some of these other details, these passages that point either possibly to the millennium or to the new heavens and new earth, there's a lot of stuff we're not sure about. We ought to be willing to do our best. We ought to be willing to try. So I don't think those passages are there for us to just say, we have no idea. I mean, I think we ought to study them. But there is, let's recognize, I've done my homework on the eschatology and really tried to understand. I'm going to be surprised. I'm going to get a lot of things wrong. I expect to get things wrong. I expect to be in heaven someday and go, oh, I can't believe I missed that one. That was so obvious. And there's going to be a ton of stuff like that. So I think you've got some legitimate ideas there that we're going to miss a lot of stuff. Dr. Oberlin?
Yeah. What I have really appreciated being able to travel so much, living in a few different countries, is the fact that I'm able to actually hear believers around the world and even what they're thinking regarding scripture. And that's helped challenge my own thinking in scripture. And it's helped me actually helped me uncover a couple, I'm sure, of many blind spots that I have. And so I think it's good to actually keep listening, keep talking with other people and people who don't think like you. Does it matter? Absolutely, it matters. I mean, this is, you know, does calculus matter? I mean, we're talking about the things, the most sublime things on the planet. You know, these are the things that God is doing. These are the things that God has given to us. Can we know you know, the Bible has 1,189 chapters. Is that all there is to know about God? Well, obviously not. He's infinite. But he's given us 1,189. So there is a precious opportunity and responsibility, I should say, that God has given to us to give us 1,189 of what is his infinite, of his infinite being. So let's be responsible with that opportunity. And let it does matter. It does matter to think through it. And actually, like I was trying to say earlier, maybe 20, 30 minutes ago, that it actually becomes worship. Not that we worship the study, but that we worship the Creator in the sense that we are actually wanting to learn of him and we're wanting to know of him. I mean, this is something I think we're going to be doing for all eternity. We're going to know God more and more. I mean, I think we're going to every day have a new awareness, like, whoa, awesome, wow. And I don't think it will ever end. I don't think it will ever, there's never, the chapters will never end post 1189 in heaven, that we will always discover and know this infinite God. I think that's a beautiful thing. So I think it does matter.
That's great. Okay. One more, and then we've got to close out so we can finish on time. Is there a full or canonical sense? Issue of canonicity. Many times this book, Schreiner, interprets some scriptures in the light of the entire canon. So Genesis 1:26, the Laodos, he says, could be understood as a reference to the Trinity. So is it valid to say scripture has two meanings, one for the original readers, and second, for the believers who have the entire Bible? And the light of scripture, from the light of all scripture, then they can understand the passages that speak of the Trinity. Does the canonical approach, I think this is a good summary, does the canonical approach allow us to interpret passages beyond the original ideas of the writer?
Do you want to start off that and leave it up for just for a second?
Sure.
Thanks.
I think we have to be careful here. When we say, like for instance, progressive dispensationalism or progressive covenantalism, one of the ideas in that is that the later stages of revelation in some way progress on what was stated before. There's kind of an addition. Dr. Talbert said this, God can do more than he promised, but not less. He has to fulfill what he said, but sometimes he adds. So I do think there is sometimes when you get further out into the New Testament or you have the completed canon, you realize that an early statement way back there was something deeper going on. I want to be careful to say, though, I don't think and this is a hermeneutics question, I don't think I'm not comfortable with this, that scripture has two meanings. It would be something a little bit more like this. Have you ever heard of Easter eggs, where sometimes in software, they hide a little something in the software? And so later on, you discover there's a little note in there and it's, hi, my name is Joel and I want to say hi to my friend Fred or something, but it's hidden in the software. Or it's kind of an idea that later on, once you understand the bigger picture, you look back and you go, oh, that's what that meant. So I think it was always there. God always meant that. And it's not a new meaning. It's not a second meaning. But probably the first people that read it didn't notice it. They probably didn't get it. And that's okay. So I don't want to say two meanings. I can say, though, the later stage helps you understand what was always there that maybe you never noticed. It was always there, but you just didn't notice that it was.
Yeah, I like that. I got through this. The canonical approach, I think, can be extremely helpful. And I think we get to enjoy that, some things in this era that other people did not enjoy. But I think, you know, if you take biblical theology, Old Testament theology, or New Testament theology, as we offer that, and we start doing book theologies, I think one thing that can be exciting is to see, like, for example, do a book theology of Ephesians or do a book theology of Jonah. And then see how that theology, the theme of that book, fits within the canon itself. And that actually is a very relevant question. How does Jonah fit in? What is he doing? What is Jonah doing within the canon of Scripture? And that type of canonical theology, I think, is quite legitimate, quite helpful, and quite exciting.
That's good. Okay, I think we got through everything. There is one more question here, but somebody had sent it to me with a kind of, we probably won't have time to this if we can. And so I wish we could, That may be a thing. It's a question more for Dr. Oberlin and kind of an elaboration on his missions lecture. So maybe that's a thing that we could directly communicate about or something along those lines. Maybe I'll just make a few comments and then I'll hand it over to you, Dr. Oberlin, and you can close this out. Can I just express to all of you that have given your time to watch these lectures and to join us here, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your heart for God's word. Thank you that this is a priority for you. You've given a lot of hours, and it's a beautiful thing. It's really, 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 really awesome that there are so many people across this planet that rejoice to see God's words. We look forward to continuing to build a relationship with many of you as the Lord leads. We are excited to share some more with you, and we've learned immensely from the other lectures that the other teachers have given and from your questions and your comments. Look forward even to communicating with you about your essays and your papers and so forth. So thank you. Thank you to all of you. And please stay in touch with us as you have continuing questions or thoughts in regard to your papers and other things. We look forward to maintaining the relationship with you and helping you in any way that we can.
This has been a phenomenal opportunity, and we're so thankful. I feel like this, that we all walk away from this class as friends and really have been able to build some really nice relationships and be able to get to know people even out of our own orbit, which I think is so healthy. I want to thank you personally, each one of you, and those of you who maybe are watching, still auditing the course. Thank you so much for your consistency, your faithfulness, and thank you so much for wanting to be part of this. Because this is for all of us. This is not just an individual thing. And we really are so thankful that the Lord has given us the scripture. He's given us opportunity. And thank you for being responsible with your opportunity. I would love to just mention a couple things regarding the paper. I have someone who will be looking at the papers themselves, your paper individually, giving you some comments on that regarding even some grammatical, stylistic changes that you can make to even make it to enhance it beyond the theology and the content of what you're doing. And so I'll be giving you some information via email in that regard. You will send your paper to that individual. They can send it back to you. You can do some corrections. And our desire is really that you'll have an English mentor. That's what I'm calling this particular individual, an English mentor. And they will actually mentor you through the process of working through your English, working through grammar, all these type of things, and help you work toward making a really solid doctoral level paper. And you know, I know when I write a paper, if I actually try to proof my own paper, I miss things because I wrote the paper. So we're wanting to provide something like this so that you can actually not miss things, because just like me, you have a blind spot because you're the one writing it. So that can be very helpful for you. And then you'll turn it into us, and then we'll be doing the grading for that. And so that will be just, well, I'll send an email. You can expect to see the actual process of how that's going to roll out. And then the last thing is just please tell your friends about the upcoming course. That's coming up here just in a few weeks, really. And we'd love to have people take advantage. You know what we're about. You know what the course is like. You know what the level we're going at. And, you know, maybe there's other faculty members in your Bible college or other Bible colleges locally or pastors who would love to take advantage of this. Please let them know. Spread the word out. We'd love to have your friends and people that would really be solid students and that would really want to be responsible with their opportunities. And so the Lord bless you. And we'll be in touch regarding the details in May for this next upcoming course on hermeneutics and exegesis, which is so foundational, so significant. And when I look at that list of topics that Dr. Arnold mentioned, I think, wow, that is so profound that would be really helpful for our churches, helpful for our Bible colleges to be able to get those. So thank you very much, and the Lord bless you. We'll see you next time soon in just a few weeks. And we'll be talking to each other via email.